This message is coming to you from Holiness Revival Ministry Worldwide, also known as Holiness Revival Movement Worldwide. Listen attentively as Pastor Paul Ricker, the International Director of the Movement, ministers to you in the anointing of the Holy Spirit. You will surely be blessed.
The people that he is coming back again. And Father, fill us this day with the power of the gospel in Jesus' name. The awareness of this assignment, give to everyone in Jesus' name. We thank you for answering. Jesus' name we pray. Amen. This morning, we are speaking on passion and wisdom for soul winning. Passion and wisdom for soul winning. The Lord has commissioned us to preach His word to all the world. He has given to us the duty of evangelism and soul winning, as He gave to the natural man the ability to reproduce and therefore continue on the world until the end. He has also given the church the command, the commission, and the ability to reproduce its kind until the Lord comes. This is the way the church of God has continued up to this time, by preaching the gospel of Christ, telling the people about Jesus. And this is how the gospel will continue until the coming of Jesus. How the church of God lives through all generations. True churches of God must arise to spread the gospel of Christ and pass the pure word of God to other men and onward to the next generation. We are seeing today that false churches that are presenting false gospel are not the Christ. The Christ of the new age, the Christ of prosperity, the Christ of worldliness, the Christ of various kinds, not the Christ of the Bible. These churches are propagating and are spreading their falsehood. And we that have the word, we that are born again, that our eyes have opened, whose names are written in the book of life, we must arise and spread the gospel, for evangelism rightly belongs to us. We must tell the truth, spread the truth to other people, so that we can raise up men of truth to continue with the truth, and we can pass the truth to other generations. Effective evangelism requires that the soul winners must be filled with passion for souls, be filled with the great desire to win souls, great burden for soul winning. Except there's this burden, great concern inside, a man can do nothing, because it is the desire burning inside that controls us, that leads us, that generates the energy of being. So passion is required, and not only passion, we must also be equipped with the wisdom of God for soul winning. Wisdom is required. So in our message, we are considering, number one, passion for soul winning. Then point number two, wisdom for soul winning. Point number three, methods of soul winning. Passion for soul winning. Methods of soul winning. And the wisdom of soul winning. And methods of soul winning. We got to point number one. Passion for soul winning. I said, we cannot be effective in soul winning without passion, without concern, without a burden in our hearts towards sinners, those that have not known Jesus. Passion for soul winning is the heart concern in a Christian that makes him strongly wish the conversion of sinners to Christ and work fervently and tirelessly to achieve this. Driven by his passion, he works fervently and tirelessly. This passion comes on the believer when he considers the sinful state of the soul. He looks at the soul, the sinner, and sees the sin he commits, and sees how sin has taken over him. For example, you see a drunkard on the street, dangling, dancing on the way, moving to and fro, speaking foolishly. Why? Because sin has taken over his life. You see the harlot in the brothels sitting at the door of her room, waiting for whoever she will burn forever, and counting it a service to humanity. What a passion that brings unto the soul winner. When you see people of various types, you see the idol worshippers dancing on the streets or moving dressed in a fearful way just because they have dedicated themselves to the devil. What a concern it is to the soul winner. But you see someone, the police people are leading that person to the police station, beating him, slapping him with wounds all over. Why? Because he has stolen. What a concern do you have? Or that you see that they are firing some people because they are armed robbers. A soul winner gets troubled because of the sinful state of the people he sees. And not only the sinful state of the people, the certain judgment of God and damnation in hell. But the soul of sinner, it shall die. The judgment of God surely is coming upon sinners. And when you see your relations, that this particular relation of mine shall be burnt in hell forever and ever. This my father shall be burnt in hell. This my mother shall be burnt in hell. This my goodly neighbor shall be burnt in hell. When you look round and see that judgment is surely coming upon the sinners because of the wickedness of their way, because of the evil of their way, and we look to hell, the little we know of hell, the sufferings of hell, the crying, the agonizing, and the forever and ever in hell. When you see that and look back to this man in his motor car, laughing, carrying a woman, just showing that he is enjoying life. When you look and you look back and see this man and see this woman dressing in her trousers, moving on the street, there is a burden. There is a concern. Now, when you look and consider that little children go to hell, those who are in the age of accountability, that know what they are doing, when you see that hell praying for them, and you see their stubbornness, you see the stealing, you see the lying, you see the evil, you see the wickedness, you see all these things, it disturbs your heart, it troubles your mind. But it is the passion and more when you see the free gift of salvation and eternal life in Christ, as is in Romans chapter 6 verse 23. Romans chapter 6 verse 23. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. When you now see the gift of God, that these people can be free, this man can be a changed man, this woman, very troublesome woman, can be a renewed woman, can be a goodly woman. This woman that people are running away from her and say she's a witch, can be a nice woman, a charitable woman, a goodly woman in the face of God. Who you see, because of the gift of Christ and of God in Christ Jesus, because of the salvation freely given, where these people are feeling hungry, when there's abundant food, you feel concerned, you feel pained in your heart. That's the passion we're talking about. Paul the apostle, filled with passion for souls, said, I have great heaviness and continual sorrow in my heart for my kinsmen. In the book of Romans, chapter 9, we read verse 1 to verse 3. I say the truth in Christ, I lie not, my conscience also bearing me witness in the Holy Ghost, that I have great heaviness and continual sorrow in my heart. For I could wish that myself were accursed from Christ for my brethren, my kinsmen according to the flesh. And continual sorrow in my heart. My God himself is a witness, because of my people Israelites that have stayed completely away from God, have turned completely away from God, from Jesus Christ, the Redeemer of Israel. I'm troubled. In chapter 10, I read again verse 1 to verse 3. Read it. My heart's desire and prayer to God for Israel is that they might be saved. So I bear them record that they have a zeal of God, but not according to knowledge. For they being ignorant of God's righteousness, and going about to establish their own righteousness, have not submitted themselves unto the righteousness of God. Why am I so troubled? They say they are serving God, but not in righteousness. They are not born again. They commit themselves very zealously, but not in the way, and have not found Christ, and will not escape the judgment. Will you therefore consider the number of churches that are all everywhere, where how people congregate there? Some of them wear white clothes, some of them move barefooted on the road, some of them tie red thing around them, some of them wear the cross, some of them can even wear uniform. And you consider the great cathedrals, how that are accumulating people, and the Bible calls some of these cathedrals the synagogues of Satan, and you see that nothing of God is taught there. Complete ignorance, it troubles your heart. You will never laugh, you will not laugh at them. It troubles your heart, it disturbs your heart. Why? These people have missed it. Oh, and see that the majority in the land, they've gathered the people, they've gathered a lot of the people. Do you take time, please? Have you taken time to consider, one, the percentage of total Christianity in the world? Have you taken time to consider, if I have wealth, that maybe about 3 billion people in the world are yet to hear Jesus Christ. And as they are yet to hear Jesus, automatically they are going to hell. Because they have not heard about Jesus. And Jesus is the only way, the truth, and the life. And no man comes to God, no man enters into heaven, except he has the blood of Jesus upon him. Except he's redeemed by the blood of Jesus. Then, have you not taken time to consider this great number of people that have not even heard about Jesus? Have you taken time to consider these other religions that are even saying categorically that they have rejected Jesus? They have refused Jesus Christ. And they're living with us and are boasting on false religion. Boasting on a man that cannot redeem himself. Neither can redeem them. And when that man was dying, they asked him, "Prophet, where are you going?" He said, "Even myself, I don't know where I'm going." Because the way is only Jesus Christ. And now, you see the multitudes of people that are going there now, that this country is divided into two. And the other belongs to a people that have nowhere to go. On the last day, can you now imagine the troops? You are going to see the other side of eternity. Have you taken time to come back and say, let's go back to Christianity? All many of these people have gone to some of these churches that knew not Jesus. They are in churches that are occultic. They are in churches that don't know Jesus. Don't even know anything about him. Have you taken time? I want you to train up yourself in passion for souls. Have you taken time to consider? They go to church, they have blind guards over them. And the Bible says, if the blind meets the blind, where are they going? They're going to the beach. Blind guides of the blind. How many of these people are led by blind guides? Look again around you and see the majority of people that are going over there to the other side of eternity. And some of them have come into Christianity in religion. Now come back and come to consider. Those who even say, we knew something about born again. We knew something about God. We knew something about the Holy Spirit. We knew something about salvation. How many of them have abused this salvation? As you see them dancing about in church with immorality. How the pastor saw the women, see the women that are there as his wives. Praising Solomon. 700 wives and 300 concubines. And yet they are there saying, is God your father? What a deceit actually in this life. What a confusion actually in this life. Have you taken time to imagine that? Do you not see the ratio reducing? Can you not see the ratio of the true church and the condemned people reducing? Come back to even churches that have the way. Come back to even churches that have the truth. Come back to even churches that have the life. And then come and see how many people have hardened to the gospel. How many people reject it and are laughing? They are sitting there hearing, "Son of my come." I tell you what your people are doing. Your people say one to another, "Come, let us go to the man of God. Let us go and hear what is God said the Lord." And they come to you, you have the gospel. They come to you, you have the truth. They come to you, you have the life. They come to you, you have the power. You have the presence of God. But they come to you as my people come out. They sit before you as my people see it. They hear your word, but they will not do them. In fact, your word is unto them like a beautiful musician that can sing well and can play well on an instrument. If you are preaching, if you sit, they should stand up and be dancing. Just dancing. Why they enjoying the word, but they will not do it? Now, come back now and see. And then let tears begin to fall from your eyes. Are we going to go to this heaven alone? Are we going to go to this heaven alone? Did Jesus die for us alone? Why therefore shouldn't we be concerned indeed? Why are all the world perishing around us? When are we going to be awakened to the reality that our relations are not going to heaven? That their names are not there? That they have missed it? That we are just seeing them on earth? When are we going to become conscious of that? That the colleagues in our working places, they are just there. A shadow for today. A little while, eternity shall envelop them in the darkness of hell. When are we going to awake to the reality that all these people we live with in the market, that they are just a shadow, they are ghost beings, dead people, waiting for to be pushed into the abyss? When are we waiting for that? In your arise, in compassion, in passion. Come, I ask you, are you going to go to this heaven alone? The Jesus that died for you alone? Then why are you not waking up to make sure you do your best to redeem people? To make sure you do your best. You know, to cry in a, to cry. Just cry. Why are you respecting a dying person? Why are you bothering about their anger? Why are you ashamed about them? A people you see anymore? You are getting ashamed of sinners that you cannot preach the gospel? You are getting ashamed. Why are you familiarizing with your neighbor that you are not able to pass Jesus to him? Why is the devil damning? He has damned sinners. He wants to come and make your mouth to become a damned mouth, a man that cannot speak. No, we will break through. I say we shall arise. Now we are going to arise because we have responsibility. We have known the truth. We cut the way. We cut the lie. We lead the way. We have the power. We have the presence of God. We have the gospel. We have this precious thing. We need the gate of heaven. We need the way there. And we will rise. And make sure we need the people. We will put some at our back. We will carry some on our head. We will carry some on our shoulders. Yes, we will carry some on our legs. We will drop them to heaven. Because we need the way. We are going to redeem them from the fires of hell. That's passion for soul. That's why God wants us to awake to real passion. And Paul said, woe is unto me if I preach not the gospel. Woe is unto me. Are you a child of God? Do you know that woe is unto you if you preach not the gospel? Let me tell you, come, Mother Clay told Esther. He said, Esther, what do you mean? That we are perishing here and you are sitting in it in the king's palace and thinking that you are a queen. That, the king cannot permit you to be king. What told you, Esther? Are you thinking that you are going to be saved? Yourself? That if we all die, we will live, God forbid. Are you thinking that if this sin, you don't preach the gospel, that you yourself will go to heaven? God forbid. Your life is in this preaching. Keep quiet in that neighborhood. All of you are going to hell there, including yourself. Forget the Jesus you say you have. Keep quiet in that city. All of you there will perish in that place, and including you, and despite the Jesus you say you have. Keep quiet in that working place. You will perish, every one of you. Who told you you are going to be saved? But you see sinners passing, you see them crying, you see them moving in the way to hell, and you fold your hands, you are laughing and say, I am saved, I thank God for my soul. If you want real salvation, for your hands to be clean from the blood of all men, go and redeem them. Run after them and labor. That's the reason why you are left on earth. I send you to labor. The Son of God came to speak and to save. And that's what you must know. Passion for souls, what heaviness and continual sorrow in the heart of the soul woman for those who are perishing without Christ. Some saints weep and moan, as in Lamentation chapter 1 verse 16. Lamentation chapter 1 verse 16. Can you hear the meaning of some saints here? For these things I weep. My eye runneth down with water, because the comforter that should relieve my soul is far from me. My children are desolate, because the enemy has prevailed. For these things I weep. Are you not going to cry for your family members that this old devil has prevailed? Are you not going to cry for your friends, these other neighbors, these other bad religion? Are you not going to cry that the devil has prevailed? Are you not going to cry for all these churches that gather under falsehood? Are you not going to cry? I say, the devil has prevailed. That old devil that laughs any time he gets a soul for hell. children are going to cry that the cat has gone the wrong of the chicken and is flying happily to where he would devour it. I'm not going to be concerned. For this thing I weep, my eye runs down of tears. Let's be concerned. Let there be many blue rest in our hearts. Why are we alone? Where are we? Now, I ask you, is there any other place so clear that you can find a truth so solemn? Is there any other place so clear to you that you can find the power of God so clear? Is there any other place that you can find the truth of God so pure? Is there any other place that you can find clear exemplary life? Can you find the one you wrestle? Why are you sitting them quiet? Your fear and doesn't bother you. Did I tell you that we're a political party? That you think that we belong to a party, we ourselves alone? No! God has planted us to bring the world. For the kingdom of God is nothing unto a living. That a woman puts in a middle of wheat until all becomes leavened. We are to leaven the whole world. To get them back to Jesus. You are alive for this business. Alive for this duty. Young boy, there are boys around you. Make sure you get them for Jesus. Those boys in your school, get them for Jesus. Ladies, those ladies around you, get them for Jesus. Those girls in the neighborhood, get them for Jesus. And let every one of us be involved in this business of getting people to the Lord Jesus Christ. There are friends that pray continually before God, interceding for some lost souls. And being a sinner or a backslider is brought to the foundation of Christ. What a joy to the passionate soul winner that someone has been redeemed. Angels clap their hands in heaven. Angels rise up, they praise the Lord, they make a joyful noise. Yes, a soul has been got for Jesus. A soul has been redeemed from eternal hell. A soul has been bathed in the blood of Christ. That's the joy of the saints. The joy of the passionate soul winner. Not over God and old woman. Born again. It was last Thursday. A particular man that remember the church, one old man. That I have been wondering, does this man understand what we preach? Is this man understanding this gospel? Is he hearing us? You see, the thing why the church, why he comes to church? Now, the man saw me last Thursday. And when he saw me for counseling, and he was now relating that concerning the Sunday message, that when the message was going on, he broke into tears that he had never cried before. He broke into tears. Tears just came out of his eyes. Hey, he said, if for riches, I've got riches in my life. Am I looking for riches in this old age? All I need now is the salvation of the Lord. All I need now is the salvation of Christ. I want to meet heaven. I asked the man, what do you think? What leads people to hell? He said, sin in their lives. Wickedness leads the people to hell. Then I asked him, now, if somebody does not want to go to hell, what will he do? He said, then the person must repent of his sins and give his life to Jesus Christ. What a joy to me. I said, Lord, is that what you have done? Is that what you are doing? That's the joy of my life. And I know it's not only this man, many others. Many others. Transformation is going on. Many others. Salvation is going on. In many others, deliverance is going on. Jesus Christ is getting glorified. Is he not glorified in your life? Is he not glorified in your life? That's the joy. When one sheep that goes astray is brought back to the kingdom, it is a joy before the angels that are in heaven. If we desire to arise in evangelism, we must recover our passion for perishing souls of men around us. In Lamentation, I read chapter 1, verse 12 to verse 14. Is it nothing to you? All ye that pass by, behold and see, if there be any sorrow like unto my sorrow, which is born unto me, wherewith the Lord hath afflicted me in the day of his fierce anger. From above hath he sent fire into my bones, and it prevaileth against me, against them. He hath spread a net for my feet. He hath turned me back. He hath made me desolate and faint all the day. Can you hear the voice of the sinner telling you, I am rendered captive under alcohol. I speak like a fool of the way. I shout in my house, you are my neighbor. Is it nothing to you? Don't you bother? You hear that I am a witch, that I am a woman, and that's true. That it's not my wish. I am under captivity. I am just led to be there. I've done a lot of havoc. I've killed it already. I've rendered people blind. I've caused other people to be lame. I've rendered people childless. I've done many evil things. Now, come, you have heard about me. You think it's my wish is because wrong is done to me. I am under the captivity of sin. You pass me by? Come, you pass me by. Is it nothing to you that I am in such a captivity? The hunger is saying, the one living on the street, wearing trousers, painting the head, that looks like a man on the street. He said, are you thinking it's my pleasure? It is a passion of sin in me. And you pass me by. You don't even whisper something. You don't even write a note to me. You don't even pass a track to me. You think it's my wish to buy? You think it's my wish to live this type of life? Is it my wish to be an idol worshipper? Is it my wish? Is it not to? Are you not considering this thing? That you see me in this bondage, smoking. You see me as a young guy, rough. I can't even pull my hair because I am battling my mind. And you just pass me by and you just go, then the ones that are in hell. You see, that they are also talking to you. Preachers of this generation, righteous preachers, righteous preachers. The rich man told Abraham, oh Abraham, send Lazarus, that he might go back to the earth, for I have five brothers. And Lazarus said, there are preachers there. The preachers have told them. Now, those people in hell are looking down to the preachers of hell. They are saying, is it nothing to you, all you that pass by, behold, and see the sorrow of our life. Whether there be any sorrow compared to our sorrow. Behold, the Almighty has made a need around us and has turned us backward. Yes, we need fire from heaven. And the fire has gone right into the beams of our life. And we have no rest day and night. Come, you preachers on earth. Are you not, is it nothing to you that you see sinners pass by? Have you considered our pain? And you still keep quiet? And you're still sending sinners to hell? You are still keeping quiet, even your relations. You are still sending them to hell. You know, is it nothing to you? Now, of the fires of hell, the damnation of hell, the eternal damnation of hell, and you are respecting sinners. You are respecting your wife that is a sinner. You say, she's going to be angry. What type of anger is that? What type of anger is that? Let her be angry and pack away. Then that she wants to die and be burnt in hell. And you say, my husband will be angry. He will slap me. I allow him to slap you. That you teach him about Jesus. That you tell him about eternity in hell, eternity in heaven, eternity in hell. That you tell the truth. Bury the truth. After 3 days he shall arise. Bury the truth in his life. Whether he likes it or not, after 3 days he shall be born in his own life. Tell the truth. Don't allow the people to perish. That's what God's will to say. Point number two, wisdom for soul winning. Wisdom for soul winning. I've told you about passion. I've told you why you must preach. I've told you stop it now. I've said arise now. God will help you. I know I am with you. If you can stop, Jesus will help you. Then I'm talking about wisdom. Because there are reasons why people have discouraged. People have tried this evangelism. Some have tried and preached and stopped on the way. Why? Discouragement. Discouragement. Others, frustration in the work. Because of the fruitlessness and other reasons. Now, I want to tell you, to give you wisdom, I will tell you, I will tell you about the characteristics of the field of evangelism. Who are these people in our time that Jesus has sent us to? Who are these people in our time that we must preach to? Who are these people around us? Number one, they are enlightened and self-conscious man. Enlightened and self-conscious man. Our world is changing. Men are receiving enlightenment and civilization in various ways. Other things in life have occupied their hearts and minds. Their desire for God's salvation and respect for the gospel message is diminishing. That's the world we have. The students are busy with academics, new things they are learning, new devices of science. They are so occupied, but they are not thinking about God in their lives. The society filled with politics and money, cheap ways of making money, the beauties of life, but they are not thinking about God. And that is one of the problems we are facing. Number two, the world and the society around us is getting filled up with churches. Everyone now claims to belong to one church or the other. Denominations have now multiplied with varied doctrines which serve as barriers to evangelism. What we now have is a religious society, religiously enlightened but not true Christians. That's what we have. You meet someone on the street, he tells you, I belong to this church. I am a member of the Anglican Church. I am a member of the Roman Catholic Church. I am a member of the Baptist Church. I am of Sele. I am a member of the Seraphim. I am a member of the Assemblies of God, of the Redeemed. They give you various names, and that shows that you should know I am a Christian already. You don't need to bother about me. There's no true salvation. This man is married to two wives, but he's a member of the church. These ladies wearing toilets and pulling her hair, dressing like one of the demons of water, and yet she's a member of the church. This boy is a ruffian, a trouble in the society, a thief in the environment, yet he's a member of the church. This other man is a drunkard, a real drunkard. In fact, it was in the beer parlor you saw him, yet he's a member of the church. That's the problem of evangelism. That's why we must speak about the wisdom of soul winning. That's the problem we are being posed with now. People that don't even go to church, go to their houses now. They are there. They are not going to church. Yes, they will tell you, I'm a member of a particular church. So, that's our world. That's the world that is frustrating evangelism. Number three, there are many hard-built Christians who claim to know the truth, but live contrary lies. They pose as competitors rather than souls to be won for Christ. That's another thing. Many churches have arisen in name. They have a name that they need, but they are dead. And this pose to be people that know righteousness. They pose as people that are enlightened in righteousness. And in fact, they are competitors rather than souls to be won for Christ. They tell you that even they themselves are looking for converts. They tell you that even they themselves are going out on evangelism. And now, both you and them are competing on some other ignorant souls. What they themselves need Jesus. That's the environment we have. That's the seed of evangelism that we have, making life tough. Again, number four. We have backsliders from the faith who are familiar with our message and meet us. And may be indifferent, cynical, or offended at evangelism effort. That's another thing. Backsliders from even our churches. Backsliders from other true, sincere churches of Christ. And they have left the way. And they are still on our street. They are still in our evangelism field. And they know our evangelism plans. They know our evangelism message. They know the evangelism methods, and whenever we come to preach to them, they are completely indifferent. They are not moved. Whatever we say to them doesn't move them because they know it. Or else, they are cynical. They despise us. When we come, they look at you and say, how long have you been in church? We have been there from the 1960s. When did you come home? You're too small to be carrying Bible and say you want to talk to me. We're too small. So we are cynical. They despise us. And or else they are offended. We will let pressure, evangelism pressure on them, they are offended. They don't respect me. Leave me alone, I know what I am doing. So it's the field, actually. We're giving reasons why this evangelism is dying. It's a frustration that people receive from the field of evangelism, and this is the dry field. That's the field. Number five, we have the generality of people who are deceived and blinded by evil spirits from understanding the truth of the gospel of Christ. Blinded completely. Deceived by evil spirits. That when you speak about heaven, the last, they say there's incarnation. But if they die, they're coming back. If they die, I was speaking to a particular old man to give his life to Jesus, he laughs. He laughed. He said, in fact, when I am coming back, you know, the family I came back to, I won't come back to that family again. I will live for a real, real good family. It is then I will come back. When I'm coming back to the world, that's what he said. A woman that was a pagan. I was preaching the gospel to that woman to give her life to Jesus. That if she did so, she would go to heaven. If she didn't do, she would go to hell. She said, son, don't worry, my son, don't bother. In fact, when I am coming back, I won't come back among the pagans again. I'm going to come back among the Christian community. When they shall be given birth to me, I will choose the Christian community. Blinded by evil spirits. Deceived. Their hearts have been deceived. Not connected. Hardened by demons. Because of occultism. Because of witchcraft. Now, and because of some other type of sin. We have all these type of sinners. In our evangelism field, and have the other types roaming about, not knowing left from right. Cannot be found between good and evil. Our evangelism field proved tough. No wonder many generals give up. No wonder many ministers now pay attention only to the convert they have made. Because the field is tough. The field is tough. No wonder. Many people have been quarreled in this work of evangelism because of fruitless effort, frustrating effort, and discouragement. Now, the Bible tells us something about the importance of wisdom. Wisdom is highly required to preach this gospel and win souls to the Lord Jesus Christ. Here, the Bible says in the book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 10, I read verse 10. Ecclesiastes chapter 10, verse 10. If the iron be blunt and you do not wait the age, then must you put to more strength. But wisdom is profitable to direct. You are using a knife that is blunt to peel your cassava, and it is not easy. You put in a lot of effort, a lot of energy to peel the cassava or peel the yam or even just the orange in your hand. You put in a lot of energy. How many can you succeed in doing? That's why you're getting frustrated. The knife is blunt. You have a blunt cutlass and you're cutting grass, or you have to cut down a tree. What a great and fruitless energy you are going to apply. That is why you're getting discouraged. Yeah. The reason why the churches of God are getting discouraged in evangelism in this present time is because the iron is blunt. There is wisdom, therefore, that says, listen, instead of putting on energy, spending money, taking all outreaches, and becoming fruitless and discouraged, sit down. Wisdom is profitable to direct. Sharpen your knife, you will see a renewed energy for the work. Sharpen your knife, you will see you running very fast, and when you see the fruit, there will be interest. Therefore, there must be wisdom. Look at our field of evangelism. The world is turning away from God because of civilization. Look at our field of evangelism. The world is being filled with churches. Look at our field of evangelism. See the arguments that are there. See the resistance that are there. See the familiarity to the gospel that is there. See the attacks that are there. Then apply wisdom. The Bible tells us, he that must win souls to Christ must be a wise man. In Proverbs chapter 11, verse 20. The fruit of the righteous is a tree of life, and he that winneth souls is what? Is wise. He that will win souls. If you want to win your mother, you must be wise. If you want to win your argumentative father, you need wisdom. You're staying with your brother. If you want to win your brother to Christ, you want to win your wife to Christ, you want to win your husband to Christ, your neighbors to Christ, you must be wise. If you want to go for and be a fruitful evangelist, you must be wise. In Daniel chapter 12, verse 2 and 3. Daniel chapter 12, verse 2. And many of them that sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake, some to everlasting life, and some to shame and everlasting contempt. Verse 3. And they that be wise shall shine as the brightness of the firmament, and they that turn many to righteousness as the stars forever and ever. They that are wise, then that turn many to righteousness. Can you see wisdom? If you want to turn the people to righteousness, there must be wisdom. There must be understanding. If you want to plant righteousness in the society, you seek wisdom. You seek understanding. A preacher that has been preaching sound doctrine, comes to realize that I've preached, I've told them, but I don't see a change of life in these people. Okay, now I will apply the power of prayer. That's wisdom. I will apply the power of prayer over the same congregation. As he does so, he sees breakthrough. He sees real conversion. People weeping for Jesus. People changing for Jesus. People settling their offenses one with another. That is wisdom. Wisdom is profitable to direct. If you want fruit to turn people to righteousness, in Colossians chapter 1, verse 28 and 29, Colossians chapter 1, verse 28, the Bible says, whom we preach, warning every man and teaching every man in all wisdom, that we may present every man perfect in Christ Jesus. Whereunto I also labor, laboring in wisdom. Whereunto I also strive in wisdom, according to his working, which worketh in me mightily, to preach this gospel. We preach it in all wisdom, applying understanding. How do I preach to the young ones to get them converted? How do I get the young ones converted? What do they need? What's their desire? It's in secondary school. What do I do to get them? Oh yes, if I can go to secondary school. I know. The little children don't have as much resistance as the adults. And if I can go there and get them born again there. Get them born again. In that age, in 5 years time, they become the adults. And yet their hearts have been gotten for Christ. Wisdom is profitable to direct. How do I get the old man? How do I get the old woman? Now, this one that has been condemned to be a sinner. Condemned, the woman caught in adultery. This one that has rejected, the woman of Samaria, the people of the South Samaria. How do I get them? What do I say? Wisdom is profitable to direct. The scripture, preaching in all wisdom. Walking in all wisdom. Oh, the cry of the church is, Lord, give us wisdom. God, give us wisdom. God, move among us in your wisdom. That we might arise in a new way to still overcome the devil, overcome the hardened hearts, overcome the cynical hearts, overcome the indifferent hearts, overcome the ignorant hearts, and still bring them to Jesus Christ. Wisdom, let the word of God dwell in you richly, in all wisdom. The scripture, when our strength fails in this business, we must apply wisdom. Wisdom is the ability to choose the most effective means and method to achieve a desired purpose. Wisdom divines the situation, the people, and the time, and applies the right method for effectiveness. Satan makes a wise use of his devices, snares, wiles, tricks, schemes, to win souls unto himself. Now, suppose you are the one that fell into immorality. After that, you became a sound Christian, soundly converted, and even zealous for Christ. Then I would have asked you, what method did Satan use on you? Because you were a tough evangelism field for Satan. Tough. Given to prayer in the church all the time. How did it happen? That talks about the wisdom, the meat of wisdom. The meat of wisdom. How? You that were so righteous, that you hated bride. How has it happened that bride has become sweet in your mouth now? How did it happen? What method did Satan use on you to make bride sweet in your mouth? That you have even bought a car by bribery. That you are building a house by bribery. You have even bought new clothes. How did it happen? How did that old man get you? I'm talking about the wisdom required in soul winning. You were a tough field, a rugged field for that old devil. But if by use of wiles, by use of tricks, he got you. Now, come, a child of God. Now, how did you become a cultic? How did you enter into a cultism? And despite the world, you're still there. How did it happen? What did that old devil do? What were those words he spoke to you? Wisdom is required to turn people of other religions that are totally married to their religions, that are totally dead to their religions, and to turn them over to the gospel of Christ. If the iron be blunt, you will then have to put the most strength without effort. But wisdom is profitable to direct. Then, arise in wisdom. Then, we will laugh at the hardness of man. Hardness of hearts. Arise in wisdom. Then, we will prevail against the fortified hearts of men. That the devil says, he has fortified their hearts. He has built them. He has built a wall around them. He has faced a great saint. We were very high to heavens. That nobody can penetrate. That soul has become his forever. That whatever we preach, if we can arise in wisdom, the walls shall fall. I say the walls shall fall. And we shall break through and possess those people. If we can arise in wisdom, let us arise in wisdom. All the religious world around us shall be converted and shall bow to our God. And the man shall see the sweet presence of Jesus. The true presence of redemption. They shall become the holiest people of the Lord. Do you need wisdom? I say, do you need wisdom? Because the Bible tells us in the book of Proverbs. Proverbs chapter 4, I read verse 5 and verse 7. Here the scripture tells us, saying, get wisdom, get understanding, forget it not, neither decline from the words of my mouth. But see, forsake her not, and she shall preserve thee. Love her, and she shall keep thee. Wisdom is the principal thing. Therefore, get wisdom. And in all thy getting, get understanding, exalt wisdom, and she shall promote you. She shall bring to you, she shall bring you to honor. When you embrace wisdom, she shall give your head and honor me to grace. A crown of glory shall she deliver me. That's wisdom. Get wisdom and get breakthrough in evangelism. Get wisdom and arise and prosper in evangelism. That's the work of God to you. That's what God wants you to possess. God wants you to be fruitful in all age. God wants you to arise in fruitfulness. For thee shall my Father be glorified, that ye bear much fruit. So shall ye be my disciple. Yes, that's the word of God. The believer through the grace of God should be wiser and should use calculative and pure methods to win sinners to Christ. Wisdom is the principal thing required in soul winning as well as in other things. We must ask God specifically for wisdom in soul winning. In the Bible, 2 Chronicles, I read chapter 1, verse 5 and verse 7 and 10. 2 Chronicles, chapter 1, verse 5, I mean, verse 7 and verse 10. The Bible tells us here saying, in that night did God appear unto Solomon and said unto him, ask what I shall give thee. Minister over my people. Ask me what I shall give you. The messenger to my people. Ask what I shall give you. Watchman over my people. Ask what I shall give you. Preacher and teacher of righteousness. Ask what I shall give thee. In verse 10, Solomon now said, give me now wisdom and knowledge, that I will go out and come in before these people. For who can judge this thy great, this thy people? But it's so great. Oh God, give me wisdom, that I may know how to preach the gospel successfully in this adulterous generation. Give me wisdom to judge, that I may know how I can preach the gospel in this corrupt generation. Give me my wisdom, O God, that I might know how I can be faithful in Christ. I can lead people to Jesus in this backsliding generation, in this religious society. O God, crown me with wisdom. The Bible says, whoever lacketh wisdom, let him ask of God, that giveth to all men liberally and abundant man, and it shall be given him. O God, I have my family members. Give me wisdom how I can lead all my family members successfully to heaven. Oh Lord, I ask my wife, I ask my husband to lead to Jesus. Oh God, I need wisdom. The wisdom that can lead my wife to Christ. The wisdom that can keep my wife in Christ. The wisdom that can lead my husband to Jesus. And that can make him pull away from every evil to remain in Christ. The wisdom that can make my husband do his restitution and follow Jesus. Oh God, I need that wisdom. The wisdom that can get this friend for you. The wisdom that can get this neighbor for you. Oh Lord, wisdom is the principal thing. I need wisdom. Give me that wisdom. The Lord gave Solomon that wisdom. The Lord answered Solomon. The Lord gave Solomon wisdom. And in verse 11, and God said to Solomon, because this was in thine heart, and thou hast not asked riches, wealth, or honor, nor the lives of thine enemies, neither yet hast asked one life, but hast asked wisdom and knowledge for thyself, that thou mayest judge my people, over whom I have made thee king. Wisdom and knowledge is granted unto you. Everybody say, amen. Soul winners, get back to God at this period of time and win souls. For he that winneth soul is wise. Point number 3, reports of soul winning. Reports of soul winning. The following are some reports of soul winning which can be wisely applied to win souls to Christ. Number 1, personal evangelism. It must not be missed. It is ever the way of getting people to Christ. Go out and talk to people personally. Go out, minister to people. As the people come to you, always find a way of passing this gospel. I'm talking to passionate soul winner. I'm talking to daughters of the living God, sons of the living God, that know that God loved them in this world for purpose of shining as light and showing back, showing people the way to the Lord. Again, number three, pan cry evangelism. Morning, afternoon, evening calls. Early in the morning, you stand up, you move around your neighborhood, you're talking to them, you're crying with your mouth, with your megaphone, or whichever way, you're crying out, telling them, accept the gospel, accept Jesus. And when you move in the afternoon, if you're in the night, you're doing so because it has overwhelmed you. You want to get them saved. You want to get them delivered. Number three, open air evangelism. Ministering to the people in their houses through cassettes or live preaching using public address system. You can use cassette. Put the message in your radio, in a radio, and place it in your yard. As it is playing early in the morning, as it is playing in the afternoon, as it is playing in the night, the people that are in that environment, they are listening to the clear word of God. They are listening to the true teachings of gospel. Some of them that are not able, that don't go to church, they will find church in that house by that wisdom. And the word will penetrate the entrance of the word, giveth light. It giveth understanding to the foolish. And their foolish shall be rewarded. Why? Of that meter. Oh, you can expand, have more loudspeakers, and then fix it in your house and send the sound far to make every person as far as is possible to hear the word. If there can be a vehicle moving around the city, carrying the word and spreading it all around using the public address system, and let the people hear it in their houses. That's one of the ways. Number four, crusade evangelism. We can organize crusades in villages, in towns, to pass this gospel to the people. Number five, evangelism by literature distribution. By giving Bibles to people, by giving tracts, by giving goodly Christian novels. It was said of somebody, he came to a particular school to steal, and when they discovered him, he said, thief, he was running. Then there was this student that was in a store in the upstairs. She took a small Gideon Bible and threw it in the front of that thief. The thief fell down before him. Boom. Then this thief, as was running, he looked at that thief. This thing is not strong. This thing is looking something. He came back and put it and started running. Praise the Lord. And that Bible, the Holy Ghost went with him. He opened the Bible. The Lord directed him to the place where he couldn't overcome conviction. And that is how that thing got born again. He's a child of God and became a preacher and witness of the gospel of Christ. Give books. Beautiful books. Give it to people. I told myself that 4 hours interview in hell. Not all that I was a rich man. I should print that book in their thousands and millions and pass the book to the world. That people should read and know the truth for themselves. Oh, that every relation, anybody, if that has been a part of me, everybody related to me by blood must have a copy. I must put cassettes in their hands. I must put this material. I will do my best. While I live, I will do my best. If they die in sin, let them not point their hand to me. Because I have done what I should do. These are thoughts. You can use literature to pass this gospel. Pass it to your neighbor. Your neighbor, you don't know how to speak to him. Tell him, here's a beautiful book. You are going to learn a lot from this book. Pass it. And you can, by that way, you can get someone to Christ. Number six, dialogue evangelism. This is having prolonged time of reasoning with the religious sinner in the scriptures. Now some of you said it's already a church goer, it's not born again, but it's interested to know what it's really arguing with you. Take time, sit down, reason with him, opening scriptures, reason, explaining. As you do so, Paul did so, and God people converted for Jesus. As you do so, from time to time, prayerfully, you will get that religious man born again. So, again, number seven, friendship evangelism. This is evangelism by loving actions and good deeds. as you do good things, gains, speak kind words, render help, render assistance to someone, you're developing friendship with that person. And by that friendship, remember your aim is to lead him to Christ. It's not because you want to become unequal yoke with sinners, no, but because you want to lead him to Christ. That's why you're leading him to friendship evangelism. Again, number 8, evangelism by letter writing. You know, you could have talked with someone, and then you come back home and put it in writing and say, hello sir, hello madam, hello sister, hello friend, I just felt that maybe you didn't understand me so much. That's why I have now decided to explain what I was telling you in writing. So you may have time to both read through my mind and go to the scriptures I'm going to present here, so you can be clear about what I am telling you. Like, wisdom is profitable to the world. These ones that are full of arguments. You say one thing, he says another. And when you write letter, he will read that letter. He will go back to those portions of scripture, and you are going to get that person bound for Christ. And that's how you can post letters to your brothers, post letters to your sisters, post letters to your relatives that are far off, carrying this gospel message. Your friends are far off. You meet with somebody on the street or in a bus, you discuss well with him. Yeah, but my friend, where are you living? I'm living in Abuja. Oh, can I have your address? Because I'm interested. I know for your relationship. I just want to. Maybe I may be there, or I may write you. Yeah, that's so, okay, number 27, these also, okay, fine. You come and present gospel. See, my friend, when we met, I didn't have enough time to tell you who I am. I didn't have enough time to tell you what Jesus did in my life. Now, I feel now that I just have to tell you. Because when I saw you, there was a burden in my heart. And I so love you that love must give, and I want to give you this. Now, you present the gospel of truth. You present the gospel of truth and pass it on to people. You are a father, you have children. Other fathers like looking for money. You tell your child that, well, of course, you should know that I should be demanding money. But there's this burden I have. That's why I am writing to you, telling you about the gospel of Jesus Christ. But you know, as an old man, I could have been going this way, going that way, but Jesus arrested me. You say, okay, when you came home the other time, didn't you see me? Didn't you know the way I was? That's why I want to explain to you how it happened. And you present in writing the word of God, step by step, line upon line, and pass it to that child who will read it and read again. I told you one time that I wrote a letter to one of my relations, and she said that letter was in her back, that she was carrying the letter constantly. Anytime she needed, she wanted comfort, she ran to my letter, carry it, read down, and laugh, and fold it away, put in her bag, and that joy. So right later, people will read it and keep on reading again. Again, number 9, evangelism through cassettes. Audio tapes, video tapes, giving cassette to somebody. Please, this is one of the messages that changed my life. This is one of the messages that blessed my life. Can you listen to this message? I feel that you should listen to this message. And look at all these messages translated. Some of them are directly in your language. Carry them, send to your relation far off. Your relation in Abuja, in Lagos, in this. I say, please, I just saw that this is just so good. That's why I have decided to make it available. My mother, you cannot hear this thing very well because you lack English. And this thing is in directly our language directly. That's why I have decided to make it available. And here is the radio prep that you should be using. And by that, you will join the people saved. You get the people born again. Again, in number 10 now, intercession prayer evangelism. This is praying for the conversion of a particular person, a particular family, a particular society. You are pleading with a hardened person. You keep on praying that God will get you saved. Then number 11, power evangelism. Evangelism through signs and wonders. Praying for the miraculous in people's lives with salvation following. You pray that he should be healed. Maybe you go to hospital, you pray for people, somebody is in need, you pray along with them for miraculous touch of God. And then you come again. Do you believe in the Son of Man? Do you believe in the Lord Jesus Christ? Since you have seen the miracle, he will say, I'm ready to believe. Again, number 12, media evangelism. Evangelism through newspapers, through the radios, and etc. Number 13, electronic evangelism. This is evangelism by telephone, by email, by internet, and so on. And then number 14, evangelism by family devotion. A relation of yours has visited, and there he has come to greet you. He has come to live with you for some days. your aim is not to get that relation converted. It's family devotion. Everybody come together. And there you are presenting basic salvation message. Clear, constant, pressing it. And saying, what do you say? What's your observation to the Lord, which your partner? In that way, you get them born again. You get also your children born again. Your wife born again. Your husband and everyone else. You can get them born again by prayer. Number 15, evangelism through invitation to church services. Come to our church. And there's a special program. Come to our church. And today is Bible study. Come to our church. Today is revival service. Come and listen to the man of God. Come to our church this Sunday. And in that way, you can get someone come and get him converted to the Lord Jesus Christ. Then number 16, banqueting evangelism. Evangelism to organize feasts. You can just decide in your yard that you tell your neighbors that you're just having a feast. God did something so good to you, and therefore you can be even a child that has been born. It can be that you bought a new thing. It can be that some of that there are many reasons why you can organize a small group gathering and then invite all the neighbors and then present the gospel. As they're eating, you're telling them, you must be born again. Because you don't know whether you get them again, you must be born again. Except you repent. There's no fruit in hell, praise the Lord. So these are various ways in which you can get people born again. I'm just playing with you. I'm telling you, you may even invite someone to present the gospel to him. And then finally, evangelism by billboards or signboards. Short gospel message on billboards or signboards. You can just construct a signboard. Do this thing. Wisdom is profitable to direct. Your money can do it. You have enough money. Construct a signboard. Fix it in at the entrance of the town. Fix it in the center of the town. Fix it at the end of the town. And what are you saying? Try Jesus. You will see the difference in your life. That one thing alone. People that are passing are reading it. In the day they are reading it. In the night they are reading it. And it is an information for the Holy Ghost to use. Wisdom is profitable to direct. May the Lord turn your life all over. All this dryness may disappear. You will really need to pray and cry and say, God, an end has come. I thought I couldn't preach anymore. I thought I couldn't make a convert. But now I have hope. I too will have convert. I too will be coming with someone to heaven. Rise up upon your feet. Do the will of the Master. Go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. The wisdom has been given to you. The methods have been shown you. Use these methods and get people for Jesus.
You have just listened to the man of God, Pastor Paul Ricker, the International Director of Holiness Revival Movement Worldwide, with headquarters in Abuja, Nigeria. Holiness Revival Movement Worldwide is a non-denominational ministry that is given to the propagation of Christ's righteousness and holiness in churches and nations of the world. Through crusades, revival meetings, production and spread of holiness literature and materials. For other messages and literature of the ministry, contact 081-3635-6813 or 080-5683-4323. or email holinessrevivalmovement@gmail.com. Thank you.